long before I realized I was in the head. And I recently brought this story into Calvert University, baptizing my fire, and became part of that community of learning value out of becoming disabled and having the rest of that. So fast forward to today, 35 years later, it's a great time to have all of these options available to us to improve the quality of our life. It's really, really impressive. Two, biggest challenge that we have is figuring out how to get connected. I'm sure that the products and services we have are somehow connected to the internet, to the network. And then the third is how do you make your products and services work? Because if you can't figure out how to get connected, if you can't figure out how to become mobile, you're probably not sustainable. So, solutions to that, I think, as we mentioned, are 5G is going to make that possible to improve the customer experience. So don't forget about the quality of life that you're impacting. Make sure you're connected and then become mobile and be better.
Thank you. Craig.
All right. Three things. So first of all, first thing is, I appreciate coming here, and a little plug for CBS. If you are a vendor out there or a company, get a booth at CBS. We did this past year. I think we were one of, I think Orcam was there. Kudos to Orcam, VFO, ourselves, one other company that dealt specifically with blindness and visual impairment. The conversations we had were so rich, not with all of you wonderful people who know accessibility and do accessibility, it was industry leaders who hadn't thought about accessibility, and we're talking large companies that even have accessibility departments. And that's part of our issue with some of the large companies is they have these great accessibility departments, and sometimes there's a big disconnect between that department and people who are maybe steering the company. And so we had a lot of these conversations. So there's a plug for CES, get there, be there, be visible. Because if we're really going to move our agendas forward in making, getting to the point where we don't have to have, accessibility departments within companies and agencies like APA. We've been doing accessibility for 160 years, so welcome to the club for you new kids. you know, I envision the day we're no longer needed because it's just baked into everything we do, and that would be so there's a plug for CES. Get there, be visible, have those conversations. Here, big takeaway is the need is we're all fighting the same fight, and the partnerships. There is so much work. Had a wonderful conversation this morning, but I forgot to be part of the conversation with all the indoor navigation people. There's probably six different companies represented here, and all of us realize the immensity of the task that's ahead of us to get every public building, every private building mapped internally. So regardless of using beacon technology or Wi-Fi technology, the reality is that until that interior space becomes mapped, you basically are limiting access. And the reality is there's so much work to be done that it's going to take armies of companies. And so I imagine that this time next year, instead of there being 12 companies that this work, there might be 20 or 30. Google made mention of that in their presentation, that they see this as one of the next frontiers for them, is mapping indoor space for people who are blind or visually impaired. That's exciting. And so while we have all this cooperation and wanting to do it, I really strongly suggest partnerships, because we get mired in our work and we see what we think is very important. We're missing details that can make it that much better. But by coming together and sharing our trade secrets, so to speak, and being respectful of each other, I think we can hit all those areas without leaving something behind. So I guess that partnerships, I can go on forever. I think I better stop there. Let's end it. Let other people talk.
Thank you, Chris.
I think I've been chosen to be
a provocateur.
Or I've been listening to a number of the talks, and one of the common narratives we're always at the bottom, the back of the line, accessibility is an afterthought. And about to be amplified in artificial intelligence. It's about to be amplified in big data and automated. And I think we have some wisdom there that can help with many of the issues that are faced in AI progress. The second really instructive notion was the Pareto principle. And this was an Italian economist who pointed out in his ruler that you only need to worry about 20% of the population because they own 80% of the land. And associated with that, if you create any idea or do any business or create a market, you only need to worry about the 80% because the 20% are not worth it because they take too much effort. And those notions are not serving anyone at the moment. If I had time and wanted to worry about that, I could trace almost every current woe that we face as a society from that, from those fairly monstrous notions, whether it's wealth disparity, environmental destruction, the lack of critical thinking, our inability to predict and notice the real threats, or find new innovations, level of incarceration, teenage suicide, you name it. And also, I think our apparent paralysis in trying to deal with some of the issues that we're facing. I think the most disruptive thing is that we're educating our kids to follow a norm and be the same. We're educating the creativity and the wonder out of them and getting them to compete to be the same as well. But I think here in this room, we have a sense of how we can get out of that. And so, rather than catching up, it's time that we take responsibility for flipping this world that is plaguing us. The key to productive innovation is at the edge. Everything important has come from the edge, not from the conventional middle. We need variability, we need difference, we need diversity to thrive as a society. And we've been talking about AI being the greatest innovation. If we create AI that can recognize and understand diversity and can navigate complexity, we will address all the other challenges that we're trying to face or that we're trying to address with AI. So, in my other talk, I talked about the scatter plot of human needs and characteristics. Looks like a starburst, and at the edge are people with disabilities. Because if you have a disability, you're different from that average, from that horrible notion of the middle or the average man. And what we need to do is not start our innovations at the center, we need to start them at the edge. We don't want to strive for sameness, we want to nurture and leverage difference. And it will cost less in the long run. Lots of economists who have looked at this. If you start at the edge, your products, your services, whatever you're creating will be more effective and will cost less in the long run. They will also last longer, they'll be more adaptable, and they'll be far more innovative. We'll be able, anybody that's doing cybersecurity, you'll be able to detect the weak signals and see where the threats are. Anyone that wants to innovate, you'll see where the new innovations are. And so my primary point is take care of the jagged edge where most of us here live, or we will live at some point, and then you can take care of the rest of humanity.
Thank you, I appreciate it. Just we have about 10 seconds left. Brian, with
your stuff. Not much wisdom in 10 seconds. But this was an important point. Can we, especially your first part, which I maybe I misunderstood, but